I want to welcome everybody by way of live stream as we broadcast again here June 22nd. Another Bible study opportunity. So hopefully we can get into this word and bring enlightenment, edification, exhortation, and comfort to the hearers and give you some more insight into the word of God that you can walk in it and be changed by it. So let's pray and we'll get going for today. Heavenly Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we ask you right now to bless us by giving us understanding of your word, knowing that this Bible is a revelation that can only be revealed by the Holy Spirit of God, and that we're dependent upon you to reveal to us the hidden mystery of the gospel. The Bible calls itself a mystery. Everybody can't understand it and see it because it must be revelated based on relationship. The inner workings of the mind of God revealed through the Bible by relationship. And the more we know Jesus Christ, the more we have his mind, the more we understand the Bible. So it's all about transformation of the mind to be able to understand the Bible. So God, right now we ask you to give us the engrafted word as an entry point into our minds, to change our minds, to be able to actually commune with you and understand you in a deeper way. The whole process is of God. You started it. The Bible says you authored our faith. You finished the faith. Everything about the Bible comes in terms of revelation, and you actually taking time to change us as we yield to you. Yielding to the process, God, is what we're asking for. The ability to have our inner man yield to the process of transformation, that we can be prepared for the end of the age and to actually become spiritual beings at the end of the process, knowing God and seeing you face to face. The Bible says when you appear, Jesus Christ, we will know you for the first time, because that mysterious darkness, that veil that separates us, will be lifted. And the Bible says when we see you, we will be like you, for we shall see you as you really are. So right now, God, continue this process by the word entering into us to change us as we yield to it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. It's the process of transformation we're after, not a bunch of legalistic data and doctrine and following a bunch of information. The transformational process will change you. That's what leads to actually revealing God to us so that we can actually live a Christian life. You know, the whole thing is all determined by one simple process, and what's necessary is the yielding of the human will. You will change if you will to be changed. That's why all these silly doctrines about once saved, always saved, and unconditional eternal security, and what they call Calvinism, everything has to be given a name, even in all these make-believe worlds. They got to give everything a name to get you caught up in it. But the simple fact of the matter is, if you don't give God anything to work with, how can he work with it? The will has to be involved, because you have to yield yourself to him. You have to give yourself to him, according to Romans 12:1. You must present your body as a living sacrifice. He didn't say he was going to take it and make it a sacrifice. You got to give him something to work with. So everything we do outside of the process of transformation and actually changing into the image of God, everything that stalls it out or stops it or makes it impossible to complete is based on me willfully removing myself from the process. I go over and start sinning because I remove myself from the process. So that's the act of my will, especially when I know the truth of the situation. I know what I'm in, and yet I remove myself from the process and to do what I want to do. And the process stalls, stops. It can reverse itself. It can kick you out of the whole situation and you become a castaway, the Bible calls it. That's the apostasy of the falling away from revealed truth the Bible talks about. There's a lot of words in the Bible that if you don't know the meaning of them, you don't get the full indications and the depths of everything we're dealing with. But the Bible's very plain. The will is engaged from the start to the finish. Anybody, anywhere, at any time tells you that your will is not incorporated in salvation, get as far away from them as you possibly can. Because there's too many if you, then I, in the Bible. That statement, those if then statements, incorporate your will all by themselves. If you draw nigh unto me, then in a reciprocal way, God says, I will draw nigh unto you. I mean, if you can't see that, I don't know what to tell you. If you continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. If you continue in my word, if you follow on to know the Lord. See, everything is about if then. Your will yielded to the revelation of God, and God then, in a reciprocal way, doing what he said he was going to do because you gave yourself to him. All these false doctrines, all this foolishness is all about me doing what I want to do and making it in anyway. See, that's what the foundation of all this stuff is. You know, once saved, always saved. I can go and sin and still make it in. Sinners and saints are diametrically opposed to each other. And we're going to talk about a message today that's going to show you the fact that as we get closer to the end, there's going to be a massive separation between sinners and saints. See, God's his mind is so beyond ours that it's hard to fathom it. But God has already told us in his word that he's going to let the wheat and the tares grow up together. So they're growing. We're growing together in the same environment, lost folk and saved folks, damned folks and saints that have repented. Wheat and tares growing up together. Then he separates. He says that if I pull out the tares from the midst of the wheat and they're growing, I'll damage the root system of the wheat by removing the weeds. So why not let them just grow up to full stature, harvest time, and then when you're plucking up everything out of the soil, it doesn't make any difference because you're harvesting anyway. So now you got a full-grown tare, which is nothing but weeds, sown amongst the wheat. Harvest time comes, and then you thresh out all the garbage from the wheat. You get everything separated. You know, get all the undesirable trash out of the wheat, so you got pure grain. That's what God is doing. So when folks get all upset about sinners around and I went to church and they did this to me, the focus should be on Jesus Christ and you growing to full stature to become a healthy stalk of wheat or corn. He uses the same dynamics talking about corn. Corn doesn't develop all at once. You get the stalk, then you get the ear, then you get the full corn in the ear, etc. Then it's ready to harvest. So processes by nature are going to incorporate patience. Patience has to have a perfect work so that you'll be complete and lacking nothing. So patient growing of something that's organic is what's necessary. So you don't want to get ahead of the process. You don't want to get out here, you know, trying to be Superman when you're really just olive oil. You got to grow to do the actual processes of God, actually accomplish the task of God. This nature has to be grown out of you. And the Bible says, in your patience, take possession of your soul. So you see now, what we're going through is what I call organic displacement. You've got a soul that was a sinning soul, contaminated and filthy. God drops his word into your spirit. Now from your spirit, the very nature of Christ has to grow out of you. And he displaces the sin nature with the nature of Christ. So therefore, the seed of God that was sown in your soul or through your soul from your spirit is after displacing a nature. And the Bible says the cares of this world can do what? Choke off the word, choke off the process. So if you get involved in caring about this world, you can actually choke off and delay the process of your own spiritual growth. That's why you learn not to contemplate or think about or meditate upon things you can't control. I can't control another person's actions, what they will do or what they won't do, so I got to data dump them. You know, you try to worry about other folks being saved, where they're going, what they're doing. if they don't want Christ, I can't afford to tie my mind up trying to evaluate every nuance of what they do or what they don't do, because it's going to choke off the word in me. The cares of this world, the cares of this life will choke off the word, and it will become what? Unfruitful. So the love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, gentleness, meekness, temperance, and faith will be choked off in your life because you're worrying about somebody else. Worry in and of itself is sin. Anxiety is sin when the Bible commands us to be anxious for nothing. But see, with all things, you make all your prayers and supplications known unto God. And then the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will then govern your mind and your heart and your soul. So you see now, we got to get into a place of just growing the nature. Growing the nature. And I told a lady the other day, I said, growing the nature of Christ in you is mechanical. You pray to lift up the new man. You fast to deplete and destroy the old man. You praise to glorify God. God will send seasons of deliverance to expunge and expel demons out of you that have reinforced the old nature down. As you go down the trail, he'll bring the times of deliverance where he's going to get rid of demons. He's going to data dump demons and cast them out as the new man is displacing the old man. The old man by nature is in covenant with demons. Dealing with deliverance is as natural as anything else in life. As you actually kill off the vessel that carries them, that old Adamic nature, they're easy to be disengaged and expelled. If you keep that thing alive, the thing in covenant with the demons just sits there, and so the demons just sit there because you haven't killed off the vessel, the carrier, the organic life is what they live in. It's spiritual, organic life. Organic life in the spirit is more real than things in the natural. You know, you get organic life all around us, these plants, the trees, the animals, you, me. And then there's a lot of unseen organic life, microorganisms that we can't even see. It's all organic life. It all has DNA. It all has a genetic makeup. All of it is defined by the genes and chromosomes and the DNA it carries. So all organic life, even the plant life, has DNA. So you got to understand that's the very essence and the very seedbed of all life, whether it be spiritual or organic. It's a pattern that formulates that particular life type. And the life type is always on display by character traits, characteristics. And those characteristics are called fruit, the fruit of a spirit. So the characteristics of the Holy Ghost are outlined in Galatians chapter 5, talking about the nine fruit of the Holy Ghost spirit. You can evaluate the presence of the Holy Ghost because the fruit of the Holy Ghost will let you know this is the Holy Ghost. And if somebody is not displaying those character traits, then that's not the Holy Ghost. The devil carries fruit of his spirit. 17 works of the flesh, a part of them, witchcraft, emulations, all the other trash that makes the devil operative. All that's the fruit of his spirit. But see, and the fruit of his spirit in the physical realm manifests as works of the flesh. But it's 17 of them listed. And then I think it ends with "and such like" or something like that. So you have maybe, you know, about 500 million of them or whatever. Because he says "and such like," who knows? That's innumerable. So if the fruit of a spirit is manifested in character traits, what would make us think that a forbidden fruit was a literal apple? Because that's the carnal mind trying to make sense of something spiritual. You see what I'm saying? You'll take something spiritual and carnalize it. That's a new word, you know. caramelized apples. You carnalize something. And the next thing you know, it's crazy because your carnal mind tried to evaluate a spiritual thing. So today we're going to deal with a spiritual thing, hopefully from a spiritual point of view, so that it will make sense to us and we can see as we go through this discourse exactly what's in front of us right now. What you want to have is target specificity. You want to be specific about your target. You want to know what it is, know what you're aiming at, and know what you got in front of you, so you'll know how to engage the enemy and eradicate what he's doing. You don't want to be, the Bible says, Paul says, I don't fight as one that does what? Beats against the air, strikes against the wind. I'm not shadow boxing. Just down here, just flailing away at no targets. You got to be target specific so you'll know what's going on. So today we're going to talk about sex mania. Sex mania. A world that has gone sex crazy and is driving people into madness. So we're talking about today sex mania. We're going to go through several scriptures here and come to a logical conclusion, hopefully, if you follow me through the whole process. Sex mania. Now, what's a mania? A mania is excessive excitement or enthusiasm. It's a pathological state. Well, you know, pathology has to do with what? The mind. A pathological state characterized by euphoria, a euphoric mood, excessive activity or talkativeness, impaired judgment, and sometimes psychotic symptoms. So, you know, if somebody's psychotic, they're basically what? Crazy, maniac, weird, shot out in the head, whatever you want to call them. So, loco, that's a good one. Psychotic. So, excessive excitement or enthusiasm. Excessive activity or talkativeness. Impaired judgment and sometimes psychotic symptoms. That's a mania. Now, we're talking about sex mania. So, you're talking about excessive talkativeness about sex. Excessive enthusiasm about sex. Impaired judgment about sex. And sometimes psychotic behavior about sex. Sex mania. Being a sex maniac can lead to becoming a nymphomaniac in a woman. Once a nymphomaniac, a person that has excessive sexual desire in the behavior of a woman. The word nymphomaniac is the compilation of two words. You know, I just told you what mania was. But it combines the word mania and nymph. What's a nymph? A nymph in Greek mythology was a female deity, a female fairy, basically, that was appended to nature worship. She lived in the forest, lived in the trees. It lived in anything that encompassed nature. The most popular kind of a nymph would probably be a mermaid. That's a sea nymph. You know, and she play music, the siren song, to draw the sailors to her. And then she would actually seduce the sailors and drag them down to the ocean and drown them. Like a black widow. So a nymphomaniac is basically somebody that's just so ate up with sex that they've been driven into madness by sex and cannot be satisfied. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, driven and compelled. Some of them are so compelled they commit suicide because they just can't take the driving impulse to have sex all the time. You know, some of them 5, 6, 7, 10 guys a day and still not satisfied. Sex toys, masturbation, just ate up with it. They start down this road of incorporating sex into their lives until it drives them into madness. Madness. And some of them just become porno stars because they just want to have sex all the time with multiple people and doing all this stuff and bathing their mind in sex to the degree that they become mad. So we're dealing with sex mania. We're giving some definitions here about what a mania is, what a maniac is, and what a nymphomaniac is. Now, I came to this by, I was walking into a convenience store the other day, and I went to buy some gum. So as I was buying the gum, I looked to my left, and all I saw was this big black butt in my face. And I'm thinking, I'm at the convenience store, there's kids all in the store, what's going on up in here? And they got all these magazines like King and all these hip hop magazines. Now it's got a cover girl that's like the girl of the month or whatever. But it says something like Tina is really hot. You know, they gave her measurements on the cover. 38, 24, 44. Wait, what? And she has this big old butt in your face, and the butt has become the new face. You saw more butt than face. Why? Because this is a sex mania. These people have been driven mad by sex. A young girl is being defined by the size of her butt, her breast, and sexual organs, and that type of a thing. It's no longer relationships built on mutual infatuation and attraction and just being in the company of a person, getting to know them and dialoguing with them until you come into a place of, you know, really liking somebody. It's just now what they call hooking up. We're going to hook up. I'm thinking, what are you, a fire hydrant and a hose? A hookup. I mean, that's the nastiest, most debased, most depraved view of humanity ever in the history of the world. Hooking up like two old dogs in your front lawn that you throw the hot fire hose on, you turn the hose on in your house to drive them out of your yard, hooked up in your front lawn like two dogs. Just driving them away by turning the hose on them. A hookup. I mean, that's like a brute, natural beast. No humanity, no normalcy appended to you. You've been driven into madness. And the basic thing about it is you've been totally devalued. You have no value whatsoever. You're just a piece of something. You're no longer somebody. Now you're something. So we're going to trace this through the Bible to show you what God says about sex and why and where this mania is coming from. And what's it doing to people in church? All right, 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9. 1 Corinthians 6, 9. These are the areas a lot of people don't want to talk about. A lot of preachers don't touch it. A lot of people, you know, just talk around it. It's like the gorilla in the room. Or the elephant in the room, or whatever you want to call it. It's right there in front of everybody, but we pretend like it's not there. At some point, somebody has to address the obvious. I mean, why keep talking around something that's obviously in front of us and pretending like it's not so? 1 Corinthians 6, 9. Know you not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? So no matter what anybody says about being saved, the unrighteous are not going to inherit the kingdom of God. Be not deceived. Neither what? Fornicators. A fornicator is going to hell. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers. Notice how fornicators and adulterers are not the same thing. Notice that now. Fornicators and adulterers are listed separately. Nor effeminate. Don't be a homosexual. Just act like a girl. Nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind. All right, let's see what this really is talking about. A fornicator is the Greek word porneia. The word porneia is used in the New Testament 26 times. What's the porneia? All extramarital or unnatural intercourse. Extramarital or unnatural intercourse, even within the confines of marriage. You're part of the porneia. Fornicators. You can be a married fornicator. Because that's why adultery was listed separately. You can be a married fornicator. So a lot of folks are in the marriage bed fornicating. And guess where they're going? To hell. Folks don't want to hear it. I'm going to preach it. All extramarital or unnatural intercourse. The word abuses with mankind. So you got a fornicator, an idolater, that's obvious. Somebody that's worshiping a false god, even yourself. you can idolize yourself, especially your emotions. If you idolize your emotions, you're an idolater, and you're going to find yourself in deep trouble. Nor effeminate. Effeminate. That word for effeminate is the Greek word malakos. Malakos. What's a malakos? A soft man. You know how people let real frilly and, you know, twerk like a little wimp, you know, just all this. So they got TV show after TV show now on TV, like the Lifetime Channel and E! Network. They got all these effeminate guys. These are malakoses, men who are effeminate, so soft, so tender, a strong wind would probably blow them away. So that's a malakos, an effeminate man. He acts like a girl. He acts like a girl. He's soft and frilly. So it can reverse itself in a woman being masculine, huh? Nor abusers of themselves with mankind. That word is arsenokoitos, or arsenokoitos, which means, let's break it down. Arsenokoitos with men. Arson means men or man. Coitus means cohabitation, or so it's cohabitating with a man. By implication, cohabitating with male sperm. So you got a man that's cohabitating with male sperm. That person won't make it in. Now, he just described a homosexual, and he called that person an abuser of themselves. You are abusing yourself with mankind. So what are homosexuals suffering from? Abuse. They have abused themselves. They have been entered illegally, sodomized, and they're actually abused and ripped apart internally from the act of sodomy. Now, a woman can be abusing herself with mankind. How? Oral sex performed on a man and sodomized by a man. You are abusing yourself with mankind. You're cohabitating with male sperm, and now you're actually, in arsenokoitos, you know, we get the word coitus, and that has to do with sex. Coitus is sex by definition. So these folks are have people, men who are having sex with men, cohabitating with men, and male sperm. This is the Bible. I'm not making it up. These are the definitions of the words. It has nothing to do with my opinion. I really don't have an opinion about the Bible. I just read it. If words I don't understand are used in the Bible, that's why you have a concordance laying next to you. You look it up, and that's what it says. People who preach opinions are detrimental to you. I don't have an opinion about it. I'm transferring information. It's just like the mailman. I doubt very seriously if the mailman has an opinion about your mail. You know what I'm saying? If it's a certified letter from a creditor, he doesn't come and say, you know, I'm really sorry about this. I really feel bad about this guy shouldn't be sending you this mail as a, you know, you owe this debt and I want to help you pay it because I'm really so upset about, look, that's not going to happen. The mailman has no opinion about your mail. So to actually filter this word through a human, undefiled, you can't have an opinion about it. You can't feel about it. That's why you got to be delivered from what? Your own emotions, your own feelings. I don't even dislike homosexuals. I know. I'm neutral. I'm just informing you what the Bible says about you. You know, you love everybody. You want to see everybody saved. And see, folks are paying a personal something to you when you just tell them the truth. Like, oh, you're saying you don't like it. I'm just reading from the Bible. Oh, you have something against women. I am reading only from the scriptures, the holy scriptures that you claim to follow. I haven't added anything to it. I can't take anything away from it. It's like God. You find God, you take him like you find him. You got to leave him like he is because he's not going to do what?
Change.
I am the Lord your God. I change not. God says, just like granite, a granite pillar. He's not going to be modified, changed. He's not going to be convinced. He's not going to be debated with, argued with. He'll just look at you and tell you, it is what it is. Take it or leave it. So you got to either change to conform to him or be left out of the equation. That's how it goes. So you see here, as you deliver the word, you deliver it basically flatline. You just read it, get the definitions, get the understanding of it, accept it, and then I modify and change my behavior based on what it said. If he told me not to do this, stop. If he told me to start doing this, start doing it. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. Okay, start praying and don't faint. You don't have to feel it. You don't have to feel anything when you pray. See, folks want to feel something when they pray. Like, I gotta cry first. So let me work up some tears here. Lord, look. Just obey what the man said. That's all you gotta do. So you see now, abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves. Now all these folk are lumped in the same pile. Nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. Note how the kingdom comes by what? Inheritance. You leave an inheritance for who? Your children. So that means you got to be made into a child of God to inherit the kingdom. That means you got to be born of God. You have to be born again. It's nothing more futile than to try to live a Christian life without being born again. You know how many people right now on live stream, might be people sitting here, that are listening to data, but they're not born again. They got a lot of information, but they cannot live it because they haven't been born again. Data acquisition, dogma, doctrine, Bible reading, listening to sermons, reading scriptures, reading books, all the gymnastics mean nothing if you have not been born again, because unless that new life has come into you and birthed you into another realm, you can't do it. You can know about it, but you can't live it, because this life cannot be lived by those who are not born again. This is why I always say it's an individual affair that cannot be faked. And the tragedy is wheat and tares are growing up together, and you can be around born again people trying to fake it till you make it. And he's just going to separate you out. He's going to identify you as what? Hypocrite. The Bible says they'll have their place with the hypocrites, the play actors. They tried to pretend that they were saints, pretend they were actually Christians, pretend they were born again, emulating others, and lost. Just as lost as they can be, trying to act like they know what they're doing. That's the debates you get from people who haven't been born again. They have a mental ascension to the Word of God. They get information. They go to seminary. These are the worst folk of all that go to seminary and get degrees and have never been born again. Now you're talking about a monster. You'd rather grapple with King Kong and Godzilla and the Incredible Hulk and all these folk wrapped into one before you try to take on a monster that came from the seminary that has never been born again. But they have historical data. They got doctrine. They got a bunch of professors' dogma and indoctrination and all that stuff, man, and have never been born again. How does the Presbyterian Church now tell you that homosexual marriage is Christian? You know why that's happening? They've never been born again. That's just a religious institution. What God is doing now, he's peeling back all the covers and showing you religion. It's religious institutions that have nothing to do with God, coming to their own conclusions from their own carnal minds. You must be born again. There's no ministry to a person that's not born again. There's no helping a person that's not born again. There's no casting devils out of folk that are not born again. I mean, people talk about, well, Christians can't have demons. And the Bible says when an unclean spirit goes out of a man, he searches through dry places, looking for rest. Finding no rest, he doubles back to the house he came from, finds it swept and garnished, enters in with seven other devils worse than himself, and the latter state of that man is worse than the first. So if you don't, you're going to cast demons out of an unsaved person, what safeguard would they have to the demon when it came back? None. That means that what Jesus said must be true. Can you imagine Jesus saying something that was true? He said, deliverance is the children's bread. That wraps it up. That's a wrap. You know what I'm saying? No further to take it. I deliver the children. Deliverance is the children's bread. He doesn't go out in the world trying to cast out demons. You know how futile it is to stand out in front of a strip joint or a club or trying to go in some godforsaken wasteland trying to minister the word of God. These folk don't want to hear what you're talking about. I came in here to get turned up. I'm high on every drug you can name. I'm looking for some women to lay up with tonight. And you're trying to hand me a tract. Man, that tract going to make it as far from as your hand to the trash. He going to look at that and say, man, you great. Man, look at that babe over there. Ain't going to be thinking about that, man. And folk out there going helter-skelter trying to bring the gospel to the, we taking it to the street. Man, what you need to do is let the gospel take you out of the equation so Christ can live through you. You're not, what are you going to export to the street if you got nothing within that's been conformed to Christ? So it's a process. So he says, none of these folks are going to inherit the kingdom of God. Then he adds this, and such were some of you. But you are washed, but you are sanctified, but you are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. So some of these folks sitting in Corinth were effeminate, homosexuals, adulterers, fornicators, thieves, covetous. He said, such were some of you. That's why you need to get saved. I was jacked up. I was crazy. That's why I came to get saved. Until a person sees the need for salvation, they won't get saved. If you think you're all right, you're going to sit there in darkness and go to hell trying to make yourself believe you're all right. But see, when you're not born again, you can't even process what's necessary to be saved. So the gospel has to be brought to bear on you, first of all, to show you you and your need for a savior. And a lot of folks will tell you, I know I need to get saved. And then the next word out of the mouth is what? But. I'm not ready yet. And tonight they die of a stroke and go to hell. Because the Bible says in one case, O foolish man, know you not, tonight your soul will be required of you. You see people debating about the end times. I don't believe it's the end time. You go outside and get shot in the head, I bet it's the end time. The end time can't be processed as a futuristic date because you can die today. It's always the end times. You see how silly it is. Well, you know, these things have always been, and it's not that bad. It's other civilizations that have had it worse than us. You know, in Rome, it got worse than this, and they thought it was the end times, and it wasn't. So I don't think this is the end times at all. Okay, when you die of a heart attack tonight in your sleep, it's going to be your end time. So you need to live now, today, like it's your last day on earth, because no man is promised tomorrow. A lot of promises in the Bible. One promise you won't find is that you'll wake up tomorrow alive on this planet. Tomorrow, the Bible says, is not promised. The fragility of life is so important to understand. Man, a human life is very fragile. I mean, you can leave here so fast. I mean, it would take one blow to the head. Something fall off of a shelf and hit you in the head and kill you. It's fragile. It's like we walk around it with the same stability that a cockroach has. And you know, when you're looking at a cockroach, like we saw one on the wall the other day, a little roach on the wall. Brother said, get a shoe. I just, pow! Last day on earth for that roach. Spiders, ants, you out just spraying for mosquitoes. You know. Gnats, you just, that's how fragile a human is. You ever seen a person in a car wreck for real get killed in a car wreck? I saw a guy over here in Riverdale go through a windshield, severed his head. His head was laying on the street, and the rest of his body hung up in the windshield. That's the fragility of a human life. You can leave here so fast that you won't even be able to compute that you left here. It'll just happen so fast. Like if an atomic bomb landed right here, right now, there would be no thinking about leaving here. There'd be no processing the data. There'd be no evaluating the explosion. You probably see a flash, and that'd be the last thing you remember. I doubt if you see the pain because you disintegrate. You disintegrate so fast with an atomic explosion, it'll burn the meat off the bone and then disintegrate the bone. Burn the eyes out of the socket. You ever seen the Bible is talking about men's eyes being burned out of the socket? That sounds a lot like an atomic explosion. See, we're down here in a volatile environment that could have you leave here so rapidly that you would never be able to say, Lord, have mercy. My mama, when she was alive, used to say, when somebody died, I hope they had time to say, Lord, have mercy, as if that saved them. Guy's a sinner, living like hell, and the car's going over the cliff. He's yelling out, Lord, have mercy on my soul. I doubt it. A lot of folks have stood over caskets at funerals pronouncing a heavenly existence for a person in hell, where they're in a better place than we are. Well, if hell is better than where we are, then, that'd be a sad situation. A lot of folks have gone to hell. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that the vast majority of people go to hell. That's bad news to a lot of folk. Your chance of going to hell are greater than your chance of making to heaven, according to the scripture. Jesus said, it's a narrow way, few there be that find it. But it's a broad expanse leading into damnation, and many there be that go in therein. So that tells me my chances of going to hell are greater than my chances of going to heaven. So I need to begin to push toward heaven, because it's very narrow and very few people find it. But we kind of got this que sera, sera. Who cares? God will make a way. You take that attitude right there and you won't make it. The Bible says you got to press your way. You got to push. With much tribulation you enter in. I mean, all these are requirements of making in. You got to push, press your way. A lot of older people in the church used to tell you, you got to press your way, push your way. You say you got to go in through a lot of tribulation. It's a suffering way. What old folk used to tell you. And here we are, it don't take all of that. Watch who makes it and who doesn't. But wheat and tares are going to part company pretty soon here. And we're going to see the glorified church. Only when the tares are expunged from the church will you see the glorified church. So that's the process we're going through right now. He says, such were some of you, but you've been expunged of all this filthy junk. Then he says in verse 12, all things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. Meats for the belly, and the belly for meats. But God shall destroy both it and them. He'll destroy both the belly and the meats that go in the belly. Now the body is not for what? Your body is not for fornication. Your body is not for sex. Your body is not to gratify your sexual appetites. Your body is not for fornication. But your body is for what? For the Lord. And the Lord is for the body. Your body is a vehicle of expression for the Lord. That's why you have a body. And look what people do. They hijack the Lord's body and gratify and satisfy themselves with the Lord's property. Kidnapping the Lord's vehicle of expression so I can feel good. And God hath both raised up the Lord and will also raise up us by his own power. Know you not that your bodies are the members of Christ? Shall I take the members of Christ and make them the members of a harlot? God forbid. Shall I take the members of Christ and make them the members of a prostitute, a harlot, or a whore? And the man says, God forbid. What? Know you not that he which is joined to a harlot is one body? For two, saith he, shall be one flesh. So if you join yourself to a whore, you become one body with the whore. And you became one flesh. So now you're standing there trying to be a man when in fact you're a little whore. So imagine a little whore trying to represent God as a man. You can't. What have you become? Effeminate. The effeminization of a man is carried out by joining himself to a whore and become one body with a whore. Now he's standing there acting like a little whore. You give him commands, he starts whoring out on you. Talking light, sweet, petite, having an emotional makeup like a whore, caring about little idiosyncrasies and little nuances and so dainty. And just, look, man, what's wrong with you? Take the heel. Well, I might get a little dirt. I don't want that dirt under my fingernails. And the heel is so dusty. And it's weapons up there. There are soldiers up there that are shooting at us. We can't take that heel. That's what we got. Why? They've been joined to whores. When the call for battle goes forth, they take a step back because they're little whores. Came one flesh with a harlot. Got the mind of a harlot. Thinks like a harlot, walks like a harlot, talks like a harlot, must be a harlot. But he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. Look at that contrast. Joined to a whore, one flesh with the whore. Joined to the Lord, one spirit with the Lord. So you're looking at a spiritual process here, where I join myself to the Lord and become one spirit with him. But in the flesh, if I join to a whore, I'm one flesh with the whore. Then he says, because of all of this, verse 18, what does he tell us, verse 18? Flee fornication. Run. Flee. Don't just be idle. Don't be casual about it. Run from fornication. It's the Joseph and Potiphar's wife example. Flee fornication, because you're going to be joined to whoredoms and harlotry, and it's going to contaminate your mind and alienate your mind toward God. You won't like God joined to a whore. What's the contrast? God gives commands. He disciplines me. A whore gives me comfort and makes me soft, and I can just lay there in the whore's vagina and just feel good. See, God doesn't make me feel good like this whore. And now my mind has been programmed for what? Comfort, soft living, sissy existence. So now I've been whored out, and God is foreign to me because God is looking for a military mind, a soldier. That's what causes it. You got to flee from fornication and stop making fornication a god. I'm bathed in sex mania. I become a sex maniac. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body. But he that commits fornication sins against his own body. the point of you, makes you sin against your own body. So the diseases, the heart problems, the kidney failure, the liver diseases, the cancer, the loss of eyesight, and on and on and on is coming from the porn of you. I'm mixing myself with ungodly mess, and the gene pool is being contaminated. My bloodstream is being contaminated. I'm taking on all this vile filth from the whores I'm around. And then next thing you know, I'm unhealthy and I'm degenerating physically. You sin against your own body. What? Know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you are not your own. For you are bought with a price. The blood of Jesus paid a ransom for your release to give your body back to God. It was a genetic rescue. The bloodstream contaminated by the filth of the devil's fruit, and Jesus shed his blood to wash us from the contamination, redeem us, and to actually pay a ransom to get us back. For you are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So your body and your spirit belongs to God. And you know, your spirit is by necessity joined to your soul. So you got body, soul, and spirit that belongs to God. I have no right to try to take over God's property and use it. I'm a spirit, and I have a will that can rise up to try to take God's property and use it for myself. See, the problem with a human is this right here. Here's the major problem with a human being. A human being believes that the physical body defines who they are. They think that the physical body is them. How could that be possible when it rots away in a grave, turns to dust, but you keep living? So that means this body cannot be me. You see how hard that is to separate from the filth of the world trying to give you a definition of who you are? Your physical body is not you. You only live in it. You are a spirit. The physical body is going to return back to dust. From dust you were formed, to dust you will return. The Bible calls the physical body a temporal body, a temporary body. It's not designed to be eternal. It's not designed to go forward past this life into eternity in the spirit world. But why do we get stuck in thinking, look at me? I haven't seen you. I can't see you. I've never seen you. It's impossible to see you. So what does the devil do? Just take selfies all day and just post them on the internet. Somebody standing in the mirror like an idiot with a cell phone. Turn their butt around it. Put it behind their back to shoot their butt. Change their profile picture every 2 days. Stand up against the wall. Turn my butt around against the wall. Look at my butt. Here's my breast. That's not even you. You're taking a physical body, thinking it's you, because your mind is joined through your soul to the flesh, and the only definition and the only ability to see yourself is defined by the physical body, and that's not even you. And most church folk can't even process what I'm saying. Everything is about the physical. When the physical is a temporary habitation for you and me, to allow God to express himself to a dying world and save other people. The body is just a vehicle for God's actual visitation, his expression. So you see now, the body's for the Lord, and the Lord is designed to be in your body. How does he get there? Via the Holy Ghost. He just said then, your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost manifests Christ through your body. If we can get that straight, first of all, then we stop posting all this silly junk showing ourselves to everybody every 2 days and get on with the process of elevating the spirit man and not being caught up in the flesh and the physical body. But sex mania, becoming a sex maniac, has driven folks to the physical body. That's why everybody's caught up in the physical body, because they're sex maniacs. Why are guys at the strip joints? Because they're sex maniacs. Why are the women going to see the male review? Because they're sex maniacs. Everything has been driven and compelled through the sexual impulses and the desires of the flesh to gratify self through sex. And it's driving people into madness. Folks get married in church because I'm so hot in my butt, I need somebody to marry us, I'm going to go crazy. Man, that's a pitiful way to be. Paul even gave instructions about it. He said, look, it's better to marry than to burn. But that's a low-life scumbag way to get married. That you can't even control your own appetites. You're just driven by lust and desires and driven into madness. It's something wrong with you. It's something wrong with you if that happens. So you see now, all these people are taking over the body, and he warns them, your body is for the Lord, and the Lord is for your body. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Now concerning the things whereof you wrote unto me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. Nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband. Let the husband render unto the wife due benevolence, and likewise also the wife unto the husband. The wife hath no power over her own body, but the husband, and likewise also the husband hath not power of his own body, but the wife. Defraud you not one the other, except it be with consent for a time, that you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer, and come together again, that Satan tempt you not for your incontinency. But I speak this by permission and not of commandment. So what's happening? They wrote the apostle. Because he started the whole discourse by saying what? Now concerning the things whereof you wrote unto me. He's answering problems in the church. Says, I have no commandment from the Lord about this, but I'm addressing this problem you got. I speak it by permission and not of commandment. You got to understand, a lot of the New Testament Bible is written to deal with situations as they came up. You and I won't get the same situations in the here and now. We've got to hear from God direct about what to do about a lot of things that are not even in the Bible. That's why letter worshipers can drive you crazy. If it's not in the Bible, I mean, show it to me in the scriptures. Well, everything that can happen in life for the rest of our lives is not in the scriptures. Somebody got to be able to hear from God, get guidance, and know what to do. That's the transformation of the inner man. That's the renewing of the mind. That's the transformation of the mind. Faith comes by hearing. Hearing comes by the word of God, the rhema of God, speaking to you real time about situations. 1 Corinthians 5. Look at verse 1. It is reported commonly that there is fornication among you. Porneia is among you. And such fornication as is not so much as named among the Gentiles, that one should have his father's wife. What are we looking at? Incest. Say, you got the filthiest brand of fornication going on, I can imagine, in Corinth, in the church. It's not even happening amongst the Gentiles, the heathens. And you are puffed up. What allowed it in? Pride. And have not rather mourned that he that have done this deed might be taken from among you. For I verily, as absent in the body, but present in spirit, present in pneuma, he's able to see long distance vision to see what's happening in that church. Have judged already. Hold it. Wait a minute. You can't judge. Paul. You can't judge anyone. You can't put anybody out from amongst them. You're judging. We are commanded not to judge. Paul, how long have you been an apostle, Paul? What are you doing? You can't judge. You see how stupid it is? In spirit have judged already, as though I were present concerning him that hath so done this deed. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, when you are gathered together, and my spirit with, in my spirit, with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, he says, to deliver such a one unto Satan, deliver this guy unto Satan. Why? For the destruction of the flesh, that the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. Your glorying is not good. Know you not that a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump? Purge out therefore the old leaven, that you may be a new lump, as you are unleavened. For even Christ our Passover is sanctified for us. Therefore let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. I wrote unto you in an epistle not to company with fornicators. I wrote unto you in an epistle not to company with fornicators. Don't hang around the pornia. Have nothing to do with fornicators. Yet not altogether the fornicators of this world, or with the covetous, or extortionists, or with idolaters. For then must ye go, needs go out of the world. But now I've written unto you that unto you not to keep company of any man that is called a brother, be a fornicator, or covetous, or an idolater, or a railer, or a drunkard, or an extortioner, with such a one know not to eat. So he says, I'm dealing within the confines of church. He says, if I told you to get away from all fornicators and adulterers, you'd have to leave the world. You have to leave the earth. He said, but in a sanctified arena where the church of the firstborn is manifesting itself, where the saints come together, don't fellowship with fornicators and idolaters and sinners who have not repented. Put them out, because they are not sincere. They are a contaminating influence. You see, when God actually raises up the purified church, Ananias and Sapphira tries to come in as liars, God killed them. And make no mistake about it, God killed those people. Do you really? Now, God is love, brother. And God, if you can read the Bible and not see all these folk that God have killed, you're blind. God has killed more folk than the law allows. He's killed folk left and right, up and down. 25,000 at a time. Whole civilizations, whole villages. I mean, good night. You can't see this. David, under command of God, killed so much that God said, you can't build my temple because you've killed too many folk. And of course, David is thinking, well, didn't you tell me to? But Ananias and Sapphira had a bad problem. They walked in the midst of the purified church, the sanctified church, the Holy Ghost filled church, telling lies to the Holy Ghost. And God killed them. So you don't have to worry about the purity of the church. When God actually separates wheat from tares, if tares try to drift in, he'll kill them. He will keep the church pure. We have not seen God on the move like God can get on the move now. We have not seen God rise up like he can rise up. God is terrifying when he really rises up, and you're still wandering around in an empty-headed, moronic point of view in your mind about God, thinking I can just ease in here still doing what I'm doing. On any given day, he might just rise up. He might just change the environment up, and he'll disallow particular kinds of people from coming into his presence. That's when it gets terrifying. He says, all these folk don't accompany, don't eat with them. All the idolaters and railers and drunkards and fornicators. For what have I to do to judge them also that are without? Do not you judge them that are within? Paul. You telling these folk to judge folk within? You can't judge, Paul. They tell you all the time, you can't judge. Judge not, lest ye be judged. And here the apostle is telling them to do what? Judge. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. He that is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. Folk that want to sin basically want you to shut up. And any indication of their sin, any pointing out of sin, makes them call you judgmental. Because I am in sin and I have no desire to stop doing what I'm doing. And no one judges me but God. No man can judge you. Only God judges me. When God judges you, you're going to hell. He's sending warnings to you from people that are trying to stop your demise. Now you come walking around and keep thinking that no one judges you but God. When God finally judges you, he's going to send you to hell. Everything before that is a warning to try to delay or try to thwart your entry into hell by sending you in another direction. And if you're offended by it, calling it judgment, your judgment will be set and your eternal damnation will be sure. But them that are without God judges, therefore put away from among yourselves that wicked person. He says, you judge the folks within the confines of the church. So if God judges folks outside the church, put them out there so God can get to them. He says, when the man was fornicating, I turned him over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh so that he might be saved. A lot of times you back off of people and you turn them over to Satan. You want to live like the devil? You like the devil's ways? You think the devil is fair? All right, here's the devil. And see and watch what he'll do to you. He's going to tear you limb from limb. Excuse me, but you wanted him. You asked for him, you got him. It's like Ed McMahon used to say every night when Johnny Carson was being introduced. And here's Johnny. So here's the devil, live in person. And here he is. You wanted him. You got him. Now see how he treats you and how you'll end up. See, folks are just clamoring for the devil. But they haven't seen all the stuff the devil will do to you. Revelation 21. Revelation 21, verse 8. Revelation 21, 8. Talking about folks that won't make it in. But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. So here's the group now. Whoremongers are aligned with murderers, abominable, idolaters, liars, unbelieving, and fearful. Whoremongering. Just driven by a lust for whores and tramping around in the street all night trying to have sex. And living like an animal. A human should never have lust and passion so strong that they dominate the human will and you can't stop doing what you're doing. That's crazy. Sexual sin can take you over. Sexual sin can make you into a sex maniac and you can lose your mind. Now let's look at behind the scenes and see what's the stimuli of all of this. What's the driving influence of the sexual sin? Look at 1 Kings chapter 16. 1 Kings chapter 16. Behind the scenes, you see this man in verse 29. And in the 38th year of Asa, king of Judah, began Ahab the son of Omri to reign over Israel. And Ahab the son of Omri reigned over Israel and Samaria 22 years. And Ahab, the son of Omri, did evil in the sight of the Lord above all that were before him. And it came to pass as if it had been a light thing for him to walk in the sins of Jeroboam, the sons of Nebat. You know, he was an idolater, introduced idolatry to Israel. That he took to wife Jezebel, the daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Zidonians, and went and served Baal and worshipped him. So she's the daughter of Ethbaal, which means with Baal. He's the king of the Zidonians. And Jezebel means basically unmarried. Someone who doesn't live in a house. She's a vagabond woman. She won't come under the actual headship of a man as a husband. So she's unmarried. She won't be submitted to a household. That's what Jezebel is all about. Because in actuality, she can't marry a man and submit to him because she's married to Baal. That last part of her name means married to Baal, Jezebel, the daughter of Ethbaal. And as her father, he actually had committed her to Baal. So she was married to Baal as a little girl, and she was a witch and a whore. A witch and a whore, the Bible calls her. Find yourself a whore, you'll find yourself a witch. Find yourself a witch, you'll find yourself a whore. Any woman participating in illicit sex outside of marriage is a witch and a whore, and she victimizes a guy. Cuts him off from God, makes him useless to the kingdom of God, and separates him from God by idolizing her and sex. And he reared up an altar for Baal in the house of Baal, which he had built in Samaria. And Ahab made a grove, and Ahab did more to provoke the Lord God of Israel to anger him, than all the kings of Israel that were before him. So you see now, he did all this stuff that was anti-God and anti-Christ. He made a grove, which was basically poles that were chiseled out in the image of women, to actually worship these female deities that Jezebel worshipped. So you could go right now to the strip joint, and hanging on a pole, you'll find a whore, and the guy sitting there looking at a naked, butt-naked gal hanging on a pole like a bat, and sitting there like a fool, drinking a beer, looking at a whore hang on a pole. And everybody in here is normal now. I'm a pole dancing whore. I'm crazy. But that's the modern day grove. Strip joints are nothing but the worship of Baal. Who is Baal? Baal is Satan. So when you go to the strip joint, you are actually worshiping through the strippers Baal. And you've given your soul to Satan. You become a part of the pornia. Why does a guy go to a strip joint? He's lusting. A married man goes to a strip joint. If you look on a woman to lust after her in your heart, Jesus said you've already committed adultery. So what do? They go to the strip joint and commit adultery on their wives, looking at naked whores. And all these guys are weak, emaciated, and effeminate. What the Bible calls a catamite. A catamite in ancient Greek and Rome was a real young teenage boy that was brought up and made into like a real docile, effeminate boy. Sometimes they'd actually castrate him, so they could be used as just a sexual object. You know, he had no sexual desire to actually have sex with a man or a woman, but he was just somebody for the man to penetrate and use the boy's body basically to masturbate in, a catamite. All the kick was taken out of him. All the fuel taken out of him. He was just an empty hole to be sodomized. The ones that were not made into eunuchs, they were trained to sodomize the master, because the man that owned them wanted that boy to sodomize him, because the man was an effeminate man and he wanted to be penetrated by the boy that was trained to be a catamite or a servant of the master as his little kelp boy. I saw a couple like that walk to the airport not too long ago. You can tell this man was a very, very rich white guy. You could tell he was rich. He just had all the jewelry on, and he got out of a car that was, you know, expensive, and he walked in with all the luggage and, you know, designer stuff. And he had this big, strong, muscle-bound black guy with him. And the only thing he was missing was a collar around his neck and a chain. He was so bound by the guy, you know. But the guy, the black guy, was his little catamite. He probably liked to be sodomized by the black dude and thrown around the room by the big old strong muscular guy. And that was the image you were looking at. Now they're telling us they have a right to be married. And you see these couples walking around, soldiers returning from Iraq, and one soldier comes and jumps into the arms of a big old muscular guy, kissing him full on the mouth. You know, like you see returning vets from a deployment, and the wives of their wedding girlfriends come running and greeting their husbands. This guy in a soldier's uniform comes and jumps into the arms of a big old rusty joker, kissing him, returning from war. Now, this is a warrior returning from the war. Sex mania. Driven insane. What's the actual impulse and catalyst behind the scenes at work? Let's keep looking at it. Let's keep digging for information here. Look at 1 Kings 18. You know the story. Elijah confronted this system that Jezebel and Ahab had set up, her husband. And the key is found in verse 13 of chapter 18. When a man had actually hidden the prophets of God that Jezebel had destroyed. He says in verse 13, was it not told my Lord that I did what I did when Jezebel slew the prophets of the Lord? How I hid 100 men of the Lord's prophets by 50 in a cave and fed them with bread and water. Now this is Obadiah, who had hidden the prophets of God from Jezebel, who had come into the kingdom through Ahab, because her first plan was to annihilate the word of God. So she went after the prophets. He took 50, 100 of them total, in groups of 50, and hid them in a cave, 50 men of God in each cave, to hide from Jezebel's slaughter. We taught a message the other week on Bible study night called manslaughter. What's happening? You got to get rid of people that proclaim the word of God. I got to silence those voices for me to take over this kingdom and bring in my freaked out perverse worship. See, behind the scenes is witchcraft. It's the seductive power of a Jezebel spirit doing this. That's driving people into a sexual, perverse frenzy. They've been driven into sex mania. They've become sex maniacs because the Jezebel spirit has silenced the voice of the prophets. She doesn't want the prophets heard, because the prophets will speak for God and speak up against this onslaught of idolatry and perverse sexual worship. The worship of Jezebel and her lineage was centered around sexual perversion and fornication. The temples had temple prostitutes, both male and female. And you worship the deity that Jezebel represented by joining yourself to the whores, joining yourself to the homosexuals. And when you join yourself to the whores and homosexuals, you are joining yourself to the demon god that they represented. So when you go out there and meet yourself a whore and lay down with them, you're being drawn into a covenant with a demon spirit through the whore. And it will make you progressively weak so that you can't walk with God. I've seen so many whores run from this message. Man, I could stack a warehouse full of whores. They come in here thinking they Christians, talking about the Lord. But when you hit that thing point blank range, that whore that has an inordinate desire to destroy men will hit the road, Jack. Because they've been exposed, because they're not there to serve God. They're there to decapitate a guy trying to get to God. That's why you preach it with power. That's why you don't back off of it. You expose it and you destroy it. We're on a seek and destroy mission. Jezebel and Ahab are in collusion together to try to make sure that nobody comes to the living God, and they use sexual avarice and sexual perversion and illicit desires to do it, to cut off folks from God. It's filthy, it's nasty, it's detestable, but it's also true. Revelation 2, verse 18. This same Jezebel has a whole passage of scripture dedicated to her in one church, and that church is Thyatira. Thyatira had been infiltrated by a Jezebel spirit. Now watch what Jesus says to it. Verse 18 in chapter 2. And unto the angel of the church of Thyatira write, these things saith the Son of God, who hath his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. I know thy works and charity and service and faith and thy patience and thy works, and the last to be more than the first. So he gives them accommodations. He tells them, first of all, hey, y'all are doing excellent work. I know all about the good stuff you're doing. Notwithstanding, here's the transition. I have a few things against thee, because you suffer that woman Jezebel. You allow that woman Jezebel. You empower that woman Jezebel, which calls herself a prophetess. Look at that spiritual displacement. I get rid of the prophets and I call myself a prophetess. What's she doing? To teach and to seduce my servants to commit what?
Fornication.
And to eat things sacrificed unto idols. You see how fornication and idolatry go hand in hand? Idolatry manifests itself through fornication. I idolize my own feelings, my own desires, my own sexual needs. A little catamite sissy boy, curled up, got to have sex. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. And I will kill her children with death. Man, that seems like an oxymoron. You kill with death. Death is a spirit. And all the churches shall know that I am he which searches the reins and hearts. And I will give unto every one of you according to your works. But unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine. 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 Hold it now. The teachings of Jezebel are a doctrine, and doctrines can indoctrinate you. What's being taught to folks that makes them indoctrinated with this drunken wine of Jezebel, that they can't interact with Jesus Christ in the real body of Christ? A doctrine has come in here that's got a hold of somebody, and which have not known the depths of Satan. The depths of Satan? There are deeper depths of Satan? As they speak, I will put upon you none other burden, but that which you have already hold fast till I come. And he that overcometh what? The doctrine of Jezebel. Overcometh the doctrine of this devil, this witchcraft working whore that is teaching God's people, seducing his servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. To that person that overcomes this indoctrination and keeps my works until the end. Now you got to keep his works until when? The end. To him will I give power, authority, that Greek word there, exousia, over the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my father. And I will give him the morning star. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit, capital S, what the Holy Spirit saith unto the churches. So the Jezebel spirit is behind the scenes indoctrinating folks, teaching them to commit fornication, teaching them to fornicate. Everything in your life as you grew up was being orchestrated by a Jezebel spirit teaching you to fornicate. All those old love songs you listen to were designed to teach you to fornicate. All the Rick James and Super Freak, all the Freak of the Week by Parliament, all the Turn the Lights Down Low by Teddy Pendergrass, all the love songs, all the Patti LaBelle, all the Hall and Oates, all that stuff was teaching you to fornicate. All the TV shows now, especially Scandal and the rest of them, are teaching you to fornicate. Fast and the Furious is an androgynous show, having women kissing women, teaching you to fornicate. Everything in Jezebel's economy is teaching you to fornicate, teaching you to be seductive as a girl, teaching you to be a whoremonger as a boy, keeping you weak, emaciating you, effeminizing you as a man, masculinizing you as a woman, teaching you to fornicate. Every talk show, teaching you to fornicate. It's the Jezebel spirit. That's at the root of the tree. That's that devil, Satan's daughter, Satan's bride. Jezebel, daughter of Ethbaal, married to the devil. You can't see this? It's teaching everybody to fornicate. And when you are a fornicator, your mind will be alienated from the life of God. Ephesians chapter 4 says, because of the ignorance that is in you. Everything taught you to fornicate when you grew up. Molested by older people, teaching you to fornicate. Bound by masturbation, teaching you to fornicate. Everything, teaching all day long to fornicate. Why? The devil wants to alienate your mind against God. You'll know the depths of Satan through fornication. You don't know that. Your mind is foreign to God right now, and God is foreign to you because you have that pornia down in your soul. You got that fornicating mind. You got that uncontrollable lust. And the Bible says corruption is in the world through lust, and he calls it deceitful lust. And it's causing the world to corrupt, and even physical bodies are corrupting because of fornication. There are laws governing all sexual practices in the Bible. You don't believe it? Look back at Leviticus. Leviticus covers everything you could possibly do, just about, that's involving illicit sex. Leviticus. People don't like Leviticus because Leviticus, it won't pull punches. It just tells you, and most of the time it tell you, kill them if they participate. Put them to death. Stone them. And there was no mercy and grace there in the Old Testament under the law. In the law, the wages of sin is what? Death. Wasn't no grace, there wasn't no holding up, wasn't no mercy. If you find them doing it, take them out and stone them. They tried to get Jesus to do it, not knowing that Jesus came to offer mercy and grace. Remember a woman caught in the very act of adultery? They said, what's the law say to do? Jesus said, well, everybody that's without sin, cast the first stone. He didn't say the law didn't say to do it. He said, okay, if you're sinless, cast the first stone, because you know if you're sinning now, we got to stone you next. That's what he was saying now. You can stone her now, but you're going to judge yourself. And we're going to have to stone you too. Now we're going to have to evaluate what you're doing. At that point, everybody did a 180. See you, Jesus. See you. Wouldn't want to be you. And got out of there. Now this is talking about the priests that are actually called of God to serve him up close and personal. Look at the qualifications of a priest in Leviticus 21. Leviticus 21. And the Lord said unto Moses, speak unto the priest, the sons of Aaron, and say unto them, there shall none be defiled for the dead among his people. But for his kin that is near unto him, that is, for his mother and for his father and for his son and for his daughter and for his brother. So he said, don't have my priest around dead folks, except for the folks that are near of kin. And for his sister, a virgin, that is nigh unto him, which have had no husband, for her may he be defiled. So if you now, if the sister is a virgin, he can be around the dead body. But if she ain't a virgin, she's a whore, he can't be around the dead body. But he shall not defile himself, being a chief man among his people, to profane himself. They shall not make baldness upon their head, neither shall they shave off the corner of their beard, nor make any cuttings in their flesh. So don't be tattooing yourself and don't be piercing yourself as a priest. They shall be holy unto their God and not profane the name of their God, for the offerings of the Lord made by fire and the bread of their God they do offer, therefore they shall be holy. Because they got to come before me and make offerings before me, and they got to stay holy. They shall not take a wife that is a whore. They shall not take a wife that is a whore. Neither shall they take a woman put away from her husband, for he is holy unto his God. So I can't marry a divorced woman and a whore. Now that is going to eliminate a lot of marriages nowadays if a guy's a priest. But thank God that Jesus came to cleanse us from all unrighteousness and restore our dignity and our humanity. Thou shalt sanctify him therefore, for he offereth the bread of thy God. He shall be holy unto thee. For I, the Lord, which sanctify you, am holy. And the daughter of any priest, if she profane herself by playing the whore, she profanes her father, she shall be burnt with fire. In Africa right now, if a girl wants to shame her daddy, she'll walk through the village naked, butt naked. A whore profanes and dishonors her daddy. You know why? Because she's out there as a public display of how her daddy raised her. Without discretion, without modesty, without virtue, without honor, and at the same time carrying what? Her daddy's last name. You're carrying my last name. So what you're doing dishonors your daddy. A whore dishonors her daddy. And a lot of women mad at their daddy will become whores. It's cause and effect. I hate him, and the driving spiritual impulse in me is fornication and whoredoms because I have disdain for my daddy. It comes like hand in glove. You profane your father through whoredoms. And he that is the high priest among his brethren, upon whose head the anointing oil was poured, and that is consecrated to put on the garment, shall not uncover his head nor rend his clothes. Neither shall he go into any dead body nor defile himself for his father or for his mother. Neither shall he go out of the sanctuary nor profane the sanctuary of his God, for the crown of the anointing oil of his God is upon him. I am the Lord. And he shall take a wife in her virginity. He can only marry a virgin. A widow or a divorced woman or profane or a harlot, these shall he not take, but he shall take a virgin of his own people to wife. Neither shall he profane his seed among his people, for I, the Lord, do sanctify him. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto Aaron, saying, whosoever he be of thy seed in their generations, that have any blemish, let him not approach to offer the bread of his God. So if your son scratched his arm years ago and he's got a sore there and it didn't heal up, he can't come around me. For whatsoever man he be that hath a blemish, he shall not approach a blind man or a lame or he that hath a flat nose. I don't understand the flat nose part. Unless a flat nose came about because it was broken and that blemished the person somehow. Or anything superfluous. Or of a man that is broken-footed or broken-handed. Or crook-backed or a dwarf. Or that hath a blemish in his eye. Or be scurvy or scabbed or have the stones broken. No man that have a blemish of the seed of Aaron the priest shall come nigh to offer the offerings of the Lord made by fire. He hath a blemish, he shall not come nigh to offer the bread of his God. He shall eat the bread of his God, both of the most holy and of the holy. Only he shall not go in unto the veil, nor come nigh unto the altar, because he hath a blemish, that he profane not my sanctuary, for I the Lord do sanctify them. And Moses told it unto Aaron, and to his sons, and unto all the children of Israel. Now, this is not really about physical stuff. This is about God showing forth his holiness. He only receives back to himself that which is perfect. So the only person he can receive back to himself is Jesus. If we be found in Jesus, we're accepted. Outside of Jesus, you are rejected. That's why the New Testament tells us we're accepted only where? In the beloved. That's within the confines of Jesus. Outside of Jesus, rejected. Inside of Jesus, accepted. That's what he's trying to put across here. Only that which is perfected, unblemished, can come before me. And the only one that's perfected and unblemished is Christ. In Christ, his righteousness is imparted to me. His sanctification is imparted to me. His purity is imparted to me. Outside of Christ, you got nothing. Nothing. Not Buddha, not Allah, not Hare Krishna, not any other religious door can get you in. Outside of Jesus Christ, God rejects everyone because you must be holy. He says, be ye holy, for I am holy. And I can only be made holy inside of the holiness of Jesus Christ. That's it. There is no other name given amongst men whereby ye must be saved. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. In him we live, we move, we have our existence, we have our being. Outside of Christ, you have nothing. Inside of Christ, you have everything. I am the door, Jesus said. You come in by any other route, you're a thief and a robber. That's the way it goes. People don't like it, too bad. There's only one way in, and you either accept it or you reject it. Leviticus 19, verse 28. Leviticus 19, verse 28. You shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor print any marks upon you. I am the Lord. In the NIV, it says, don't tattoo your body, which is what he's saying. Do not tattoo yourself. Will the devil tell you with the doctrines of Jezebel being preached? Cover yourself in tattoos. In that same little magazine rack at the convenience store, they got a magazine called Urban Tattoos. Black women on the covers, covered with tattoos from head to toe. Even tattooing names of people in their faces, their own names across their cheeks, stuff in the forehead, from head to toe covered in tattoos. Urban tattoos. The girl on the cover of that magazine standing there in a bikini, covered in tattoos with a gold grill in her mouth, smiling. Urban tattoos. I'm thinking this is the daughter of Frankenstein. What would possess you to inject ink into your skin with a needle, cutting under your flesh, injecting ink as it goes, permanently marking yourself for life other than a demon? Can you imagine how you look at 75 covered in tattoos? All wrinkled up and dried up covered in tattoos. Used to look like a billboard. Now you look like 5 miles of bad road. Wrinkled up sheets out of the dryer. Crazy. Tattooing is madness. Where does it come from? Old Jezebel spirit sitting back in the cut, dedicating you to demons, dedicating you to spirits of sexual perversion and fornication, dedicating you to all the gods and goddesses that she worships as a daughter of Baal. That's the driving influence. You know the biggest problem in church right now? And I'll tell you what it is. Churchianity and religion hates any discussion of anything that is supernatural, metaphysical, extraterrestrial, and interdimensional. They want to keep everything bound to the natural realm. And they'll have you doing all this stuff that won't benefit you not one iota until you deal with the spirits that rule the insane asylum. It's an asylum ruled by the demons. They always say, man, it's a bad state of affairs when the inmates rule the asylum. So here you have the devil now raising up the inmates that should be governed and led to freedom or led to sanity, and they've taken over. Any discussion of anything metaphysical and supernatural is downplayed. I'm going to show you a good example of it in just a minute. They don't like it. They don't like that. That's why the book of Enoch was left out of the Bible. Because the book of Enoch is too metaphysical. It exposes too much satanic fallen angel data. Now, we don't want that in here because that's just opening the veil too much. And it's revealing too much. Folks don't like discussions about supernatural things. They put the brakes on hard when you bring up supernatural things. What's causing that? The indoctrination of the Jezebel spirit. She defines worship. It defines worship. It won't let you go past the parameters that it set up for you to worship in because it's a controlled religious spirit that governs a controlled religious environment. So you see now, don't mark your body up. Do not prostitute thy daughter to cause her to be a whore, lest the land fall to what? What's America falling to? Whoredoms. Being a whore is in vogue. Everybody dressed like a stripper, a slut, a 10-cent whore on the street, a prostitute. The fashion trends dictate that you look like a whore. That's in style. The land has fallen to whoredoms, and the land become full of what? Wickedness. You can't see this. We're following these dictates to the letter. To the letter. You shall keep my Sabbaths and reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord. Regard not them that have familiar spirits, neither seek after wizards to be defiled by them. I am the Lord your God. Harry Potter. All these witchcraft shows. All these shows like The Coven. The Witches of Eastwick. It goes on and on and on. Says don't deal with familiar spirits and wizards. And Harry Potter, man, has turned a generation of kids into warlocks, witches, and sorcerers. Thou shalt rise up before the hoary head and honor the face of the old man and fear thy God. I am the Lord. You find very few young people that know how to honor and reverence older people. They don't call them sir anymore. Yes, sir. Or Mr. So-and-so. They try to be on a first name basis with somebody that's four times older than them. That's garbage. That's garbage. You got to learn to honor the elderly. Honor those that are older than you according to the Bible. Disrespecting what the Bible calls the hoary head, the gray hair, the older people is a sign that the generations have gone into rebellion. It's out of control. Leviticus chapter 18. All forbidden sexual practices. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, I am the Lord your God. After the doings of the land of Egypt wherein you dwelt shall you not do. And after the doings of the land of Canaan, whither I bring you, shall you not do. Neither shall you walk in their ordinances. You shall do my judgments and keep mine ordinances to walk therein. I am the Lord your God. You shall therefore keep my statutes and my judgments, which if a man do, he shall live in them. I am the Lord. None of you shall approach to any that is near of kin to him to uncover their nakedness. I am the Lord. No incest. The nakedness of thy father or thy mother, or the nakedness of thy mother shalt thou not uncover. She is thy mother. Thou shalt not uncover her nakedness. The nakedness of thy father's wife shalt thou not uncover. It is thy father's nakedness. So you see what happened in Corinth? Fornication that is not even mentioned among the Gentiles, to have your father's wife. And God is warning about this way back in Leviticus. Rules against incest is what he's going through. The nakedness of thy father's wife shalt thou not uncover, is thy father's nakedness. The nakedness of thy sister, the daughter of thy father, or daughter of thy mother, whether she be born at home or born abroad, even their nakedness thou shalt not uncover. So if she's your stepsister, leave her alone, because your mama had her or your daddy had her. Don't uncover her nakedness. The nakedness of thy son's daughter or of thy daughter's daughter, even their nakedness thou shalt not uncover, for theirs is thine own nakedness. The nakedness of thy father's wife's daughter, begotten of thy father, she is thy sister, thou shalt not uncover her nakedness. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy father's sister, she is thy father's near kinswoman. So he said, don't have sex with your aunt. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy mother's sister, for she is thy mother's near kinswoman. Your mother's sister is your aunt. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy father's brother. Thou shalt not approach to his wife. She is thine aunt. I don't know why they didn't call her the aunt in verse 12 and 13. It would have been easier. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy daughter-in-law. She is thy son's wife. Thou shalt not uncover her nakedness. So don't be taking your son's wife and having sex with her. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy brother's wife. It is thy brother's nakedness. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of a woman and her daughter. Neither shalt thou take her son's daughter or her daughter's daughter to uncover her nakedness. For they are her near kinsmen, kinswomen. It is wickedness. Neither shalt thou take a wife to her sister to vex her, to uncover her nakedness, because the other in her lifetime. So in other words, you got a wife. Don't be trying to get her sister to vex your wife in her lifetime to marry her sister. Also, thou shalt not approach unto a woman to uncover her nakedness, as long as she is put apart for her uncleanness. Now, what's her uncleanness? She's on her menstrual cycle. I met a guy who says he loves to have oral sex with women on their menstrual cycle. So that's what you're dealing with. I'm dealing with people for real, hardcore folk that live a life of depravity. That's the hand we've been dealt. That's the hand we've got to play. Moreover, thou shalt not lie carnally with thy neighbor's wife to defile thyself with her. And thou shalt not let any of thy seed pass through the fire to Molech. Neither shalt thou profane the name of thy God. I am the Lord. Abortion. Passing through the fire unto Molech, offering the babies up to Molech. Thou shalt not lie with womankind. Well, I'm trying to lie with mankind as with womankind. It is abomination. You find that the false church, the Jezebel spirit in Revelation, is the queen that sires whoredoms and abominations. Whoredoms and homosexuality and lesbianism is flowing from the loins of the Jezebel spirit, which is actually seated in churches. Jezebel is a religious spirit. It does not operate outside the confines of religion. It actually captivates religion and then spews forth the damage from within the confines of church. The Bible calls it a harlot church. Neither shalt thou lie with any beast to defile thyself therewith. Neither shall any woman stand before a beast to lie down thereto. It is confusion. They make pornography full of bestiality. women having sex with mules, horses, and donkeys. Sailors will tell you in the Navy, you go down to Mexico and pull in the port, and they feature the donkey shows with the pretty little Mexican girls having sex live on stage with donkeys. Why is God wanting not to do it? Because a human is able to cascade into the depths of depravity because they understand and know the depths of Satan. Satan can turn you into an animal to the degree that you have an appetite to have sex with other animals. Defile not you yourselves in any of these things, for in all these the nations are defiled which I cast out before you. And the land is defiled, therefore I do visit the iniquity thereof upon it, and the land itself vomits out her inhabitants. What's going to happen to America? The land itself will begin to vomit out the inhabitants. The actual atmosphere, the weather patterns, earthquakes, everything will begin to vomit out the human race that is contaminating the arena. He says the land will vomit you out. You shall therefore keep my statutes and my judgments and shall not commit any of these abominations, neither any of your own nation nor any stranger that sojourns among you. For all these abominations have the men of the land done, which were before you, and the land is defiled. The land is nasty because of the sexual perversion that was on the land. He says, all these nations, these men before you, did the things that I'm telling you not to do. So it's possible for a human to do it. They did it. That the land spew not you out also when you defile it, as it spewed out the nations that were before you. For whosoever shall commit any of these abominations, now hear me, homosexual, even the souls that commit them shall be cut off from among their people. AIDS. The HIV virus that leads to AIDS will kill you off all by itself. Therefore shall you keep mine ordinance that you commit not any of these abominable customs which were committed before you, and that you defile not yourselves therein. I am the Lord your God. So you see, sex mania, sex maniacs, gone crazy, having sex with anything that's not tied down. Daughters, cousins, aunts, uncles, grandfathers, grandmothers. Crazy. I saw a picture the other day on the internet where a 30-year-old boy is now having sex with his 74-year-old grandmother. Mothers pregnant by their own sons. Fathers having kids by his daughters. Four or five daughters, everybody getting pregnant by their daddy. You can be driven into complete, total depravity and insanity and become a sex maniac, a freak, a kook, a nutcase. To the degree you come to the gospel, hear the truth, and you're still driven to the pornography. You're still driven to the depravity. Can't stop masturbating. Your mind is rotting out in the very fabric of your head. Your mind is rotting away. The fabric of all sensitivity, normalcy, decency, everything eradicated. And you become a walking, talking, breathing animal because you can't get out of this maze of sexual perversion and addiction. And only the blood of Jesus can set you free. He has to eradicate the old man, the nature that possesses you, kill it, and let the new nature of Christ grow organically out of you. And the Bible calls that process transformation. He even mentioned that same sin again in Leviticus 20:13. If a man also lie with mankind as he lies with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination, they shall surely be put to death. Their blood shall be upon them. He warns twice in Leviticus, chapter 18 and 20, 18:22 and 20:13, to lie with a man, like you lie with a woman is an abomination. An abomination means it's detestable, it's filthy, it's just totally unnatural. The Hebrew word is toaba. It's toaba, to lie with a man like you lie with a woman. You're filthy, you're detestable, you're an abomination. And now they're trying to tell me and you, contrary to the Bible, that, oh, this is normal. They're the new group of people that's being discriminated against. This is not what the Bible says, Mr. President. I don't care what anybody else says. The word of God stands true. God is not going to be moved one inch. Like one guy, a brother that used to be a homosexual said, it's the perfect phrase for this. He says, homosexuality and lesbianism is not an orientation. Homosexuality is a manifestation of a demon. It's not an orientation. It's a manifestation. It's showing the demon in the person on the outside. The demon used to keep the person they had bound where? In the closet. He had them in a closet, practicing the appetites of the demon, because the demon knew instinctively what? What did the demon know? And why did that demon keep that person in a closet? Huh? Society wouldn't accept them. So the demon kept the people in the closet because I want to enjoy my appetites, and I know the society at large won't accept this. So therefore, I'll keep you bound in the closet, not telling people, so I can enjoy my appetite. But I'll be working behind the scene to get the society and the culture to accept my coming out. It's a demon. It's working to make the environment compatible to itself so it won't be ostracized and it can openly practice the appetites of the demon. That's all that's happening, man. You mentioned that in church, I'm a psychopath. I'm crazy. Oh, man, you're a nut. So the Presbyterian church does what? It abdicates. Homosexual marriage is Christian. You can't make that proclamation, man. You can't define marriage when God already defines it as a male and a female, a man and a woman. You can't change the word of God unless you're already bathed in antichrist spirits. You hate God while claiming to be the church of God. You despise God and you're an antichrist. That's what we're facing. That's what we're up against. But I'm going to show you something even more diabolical. Even more diabolical. Look at Psalm 145. Psalm 145. The devil in the depths of Satan as we speak. Even more diabolical. Something is going on here that you try to figure out what is this. And God has to reveal it to you because it's not on the surface. You can't figure out what's going on unless you have a look back behind the scenes. Psalm 145, verse 17. Psalm 145, verse 17. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and holy in all his works. The Lord is nigh unto all them that call upon him, to all that call upon him in what? You can't be a hypocrite. He's going to read the inside of you. You got to be for real calling on God. He's going to know if you're a hypocrite fooling around or if you're serious. He's nigh unto all them that call upon him in truth. You want to be a homosexual and delivered? You got to come right. You got to come seriously. You can't play with that demon because it's a strong man. He will fulfill the desire of them that fear him. He will fulfill the desire of him that fear him. Only those that fear God will have their desires fulfilled. He also will hear their cry and will save them, deliver them. The Lord preserveth all them that love him, but all the wicked will he destroy. All the wicked he will destroy. My mouth shall speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. Don't think God won't destroy you, because he will. He will. So what's the diabolical thing going on? Folks are hung up in these sexually perverse spirits. And they're walking around as if they're in alignment with and in covenant with the church, the real church, the truth of God. But guess what happened? They can't do anything participatory within the realms of the real church, because they're bound by the perverse spirits. They really can't participate in anything. They can only look at it. Right now we're broadcasting. We'll have 1,000 views of this message. And the majority of the people listening can't do one thing participatory in the body of Christ. All they can do is sit back and look and can't participate, because they're bound by these spirits. Why did the Presbyterian Church this week say that homosexuality is Christian? Why did the same Presbyterian Church disavow Israel? They're antichrist. What's going on? Netanyahu told him, he said, look, you can fall into alignment with the surrounding nations around Israel, but two things you better know. You go to one of those nations, you better be driving in an armored car. And the second thing you better know, Presbyterians, is that you better not tell them you're Christians. You can come to Israel and say you're a Christian. We won't bother you. Go to the Islamic republics around us and tell them that. While you disavow and disallow Israel, that's telling you they're antichrist. The church itself is antichrist. It's standing with the devil against God's people. And don't ever get it twisted in your little mind. All these folks that try to preach a hatred of Israel from a pulpit, Israel birthed the church, because the first church folk were Jews, Jack, not Gentiles. The Bible says the Jews are the root of the church. He's going to engraft back in a remnant of them at the end. He says, look, the root holds the tree up. The tree don't hold the root up. So you turn against these Jews if you want to. You can become anti-Israel if you want to. You're going to be cursed. I will bless them that bless Israel. This is God speaking. I will curse them that curse Israel. So therefore, God, I wanted to go on the record. Me personally, Gary Price, today, June 22nd, 2014, I bless Israel. For as for me, I bless Israel. I hope they're prosperous. Let them always be fervent for God. Let them grow in grace. Let them be saved. The apostle says, my prayer for Israel is that they all be saved. Said, I would even almost desire to give up my own salvation that Israel would be saved. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. He that loves her, they will prosper. So, hey, man, I'm on record. You better get on record personally. In your prayer time, take time to bless Israel. Save them. Prosper them. Folks always like to talk about the Jews. The Jews doing this. The Jews got all the money. The Jews behind the scenes. You better leave those Jews alone, what you better do. And folks can get hyped up about this now. When they're not saved, that ain't my problem. I don't have nothing to do with that. That's God's business. I do as I'm told concerning Israel. You better stop feeling anything contrary about those folks, because they are still Abraham's lineage through Isaac. See, all the surrounding tribes around them that hate them, they're Abraham's lineage. But guess who they came through? Ishmael. The children of the bondwoman are not treated the same as the children of the free woman. The children of Sarah and the children of Hagar are not the same. God separated that up. And then he blessed the children of Hagar. He blessed the Ishmaelites. You wonder why they're sitting over there on top of all that oil. You know why they're sitting on top of that oil? Because God knew the oil was there. He gave them the right, they went right to the land with all the oil. Trillions of dollars over there. Some of those Arab sheiks live in houses that look like, you can take the biggest Marriott you've ever seen. They live in a house. If you look at the pictures of the fishers in the house, they got golden toilets, golden sinks. I mean, it's everything pure gold. It's crazy. We just looked at a marriage show, me and Barbara, this morning, where an Indian girl was getting married. Her wedding cost $1.3 million. I'm thinking, you know, down at the courthouse, you know, $25 maybe for a marriage license, we in there 15 minutes, it's over. $1.3 million, and their weddings can last up to a week long. I mean, they have just, it's so much food, so much. You thinking, man, this is wild. And her daddy said, I told my daughter, money is no object. We want you to have whatever you want, your heart's desire, we want you to have it. And of course, the Indians got money just flowing. All of them doctors and all this kind of stuff. Everybody's got money. I mean, relatives come on board too, like her daddy's brother would be. You know, everybody just in it. You know what I'm saying? It's just $1.3 million. The flowers alone, I think, was something like $375,000. So what am I saying? This is the point I'm making. Because of sexual sin, because of being yoked to the Jezebel spirit through fornication, the church has been disempowered. What was the Trojan horse? Tom taught a good lesson Wednesday night about the fifth column. It's a fifth column somewhere that everybody's trying to figure out, where is the disempowering element? There has to be a fifth column somewhere. It's something happening that's disempowering the church. How the devil get in? I got a message from a guy the other day. Wrote me a long letter. Well, it wasn't that long. Maybe, you know, short letter compared to some of the letters I get with people cussing me out and yelling at me. It was pretty short. So, the guy said, I've been a pastor for 30 years. He said, Price, what you're teaching is right about the oral sex spirit. So years ago, I addressed that thing. It blew the church up, tore it in half, tore it apart. The folk was mad. They hated to hear it. But that's the devil's stealth, underhanded Trojan horse. The people are participating in oral sex. That's how he got in. They are sodomites. That's what's wrong in that Presbyterian church. That's why you get once saved, always saved, spewing forth from Baptists. That's why people shut their mouths about homosexual behavior. Because they instinctively know the folks sitting in front of me are doing the same thing. What does it say? Romans chapter 1. This is the nullifier of people being able to prosecute an effective warfare in the real church. This is why people sit right now on live stream looking and can't do one thing about anything, because they're bound to the sodomite spirit in their souls. He ended the discourse in Romans 1 and verse 32. He ended it by saying this: who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. You know the judgment of God. We just read in Leviticus all the perversion that can exist sexually in people's lives. He went through the discourse in Romans chapter 1, telling you can be given over to uncleanness, vile affections, and finally a reprobate mind. It started out with heterosexuals doing what? Dishonoring their bodies amongst themselves with each other, heterosexuals. It then cascaded down into homosexuality and ended in a reprobate mind. Read it for yourself, Romans chapter 1. So the devil brought the Trojan horse of participation in oral sex into the church, got the folks locked down, even those that have stopped doing it can't move to do anything because the demons got them on lockdown. So trillions of dollars are being spent on religion, churchianity, the filthiness and perversion taught by a Joel Osteen or a T.D. Jakes and all these perverse ministries. And the folks sit looking like deers in headlights when somebody just tells the truth. Sex maniacs bound by a Jezebel spirit and the witchcraft that came from a whore. You join yourself to a whore. You become one flesh with the whore. You can't move. Remember when Elijah confronted Jezebel? He said, look, either choose God or Baal. And the folks answered not a word. They're petrified. They can't move. It's impossible to preach this message and not get the real body of Christ to just stand up like a massive army and say, you know what? Let's march against the enemy. This is it. This is right. We've been looking for some leadership that's going to stand up against the adversary. Look how they all just sit there like deers in the headlight, can't move. Stalled out. Because that same sex maniac spirit that has bound you with pornography, illicit sex, oral sex, anal sex. Some of you are participating in bestiality, incest. You molested your little cousin when you were growing up, doing stuff to him or her. All that stuff is compiled in your soul and it's got you stalled out, unable to move. Your mind is confused. You don't know what to do. You don't know if you're in the world or out of it. You don't know if it's something plaguing you still from your past. You got all this doubt, all this fear, all this unbelief, all this anxiety, all this stuff that's clogging up your flow with God. Cholesterol is inundating your spiritual senses. You can't move forward and you can't go in reverse. You don't know who you are, what you are, where you're going, why you're going. And all the while, he just told you in Psalm 145, you come to me and cry to me in truth. You come to me and acknowledge your transgressions. You come to me and get for real. I will expunge all the filth out of you and make you over brand new. The false is wiser in their generation than the children of light. That's what Jesus said in my own interpretation. He says the children of darkness, the children of the devil, are wiser in their generation than the children of light, the children of God. So what do? They come together and combine resources, stand together as one army against Christ and the church, and they got power because they come together on one accord and stand up as a force against Christ. They are totally anti-Christ. And most of the Antichrist spirit is behind the walls of the church, what we call the church, which is just basically Babylonian religion. So why not step out of that, stand up, and man up, woman up, and divest yourself of all these sex maniac, depraved, filthy spirits, and become one spirit with the Lord. You were one flesh with the whore. So why not become one spirit with the Lord and fight against the whore? It makes perfect sense. Every Sunday they'll get in the church and pass a tray around and it'll be piled up full of money to fuel the whole entity to make sure it does what it does. Because I'm participating in this illicit oral sex demon. It's a demon. If you're practicing oral sex as a married couple, you are demonized. Your marriage bed is defiled. You're demon possessed. You need help outside of yourself. The appetite and the demon's appetite will make you fight what I'm saying. Your mind is already in a frenzy saying that's not right, because that's the demon talking to your mind. Your mind is already saying, well, Song of Solomon says you can participate in oral sex. You can't find that in the Song of Solomon one time. That's made up. That's just the position of the scripture to validate my depravity. That's all it is. I'm changing the Bible to accommodate my depravity, because I want to do it, because I'm in collusion. I'm in covenant with the demon. That demon's got your mind so jacked up. It's got your appetite so jacked up. It's got your desires so jacked up that you would go to hell as an oral sex practitioner before you come to Jesus Christ to let him purge that sin from your contaminated soul. You've been driven into madness and you don't even know it. Your mind is already functioning like that on live stream if you're a participator in these depraved activities. Your mind is already going into chaos. Your mind is already getting mad. You're already irritated. You're already reaching for the computer screen to shut her down. Why? Because that demon don't want to hear this. That demon is fighting you tooth and nail. Folks said, why do you keep bringing up? That's the Trojan horse. That's the filth column. That's the thing that snuck in unawares. Jezebel and her depraved religious practices have come in under the radar screen to bind the church. So when you preach it, you see a glass ceiling stops the people. They can't move, because that demon won't let you move. That demon will give you every excuse in the world not to move. It will delay. It will procrastinate. It will put off what you know you should do to move on, trying to keep you bound. They pass an offering tray every week in these false churches, gathering more money to fuel the empires of bondage, to make sure you remain soulish, make sure you only lock up in the physical realm, bragging about what they do to church folk to keep them bound. So a guy the other day bragging about being now put forth as a minister to teach at the Woman Thou Art Loose conference. He don't even know he's chained up to a homosexual spirit. Why doesn't he know it? He's got it in himself. You got the homosexual spirit in you, so you think T.D. Jakes is some kind of father in the Lord or something. Blind as the proverbial bat because of unclean spirits. Look how Jesus always called them unclean spirits. Nasty sex dog spirits. Sitting up like animals doing depraved sexual filth. And happy. Happy as a lark. Going to church every Sunday. Lost. Damned to hell. And nobody will even warn them. Get up. Move out. Move up. And do something about it. Fast and pray your way into another paradigm for life. Extricate yourself from the bondages and the strongholds of that demon. I don't care what your husband likes. I don't care what your wife likes. Your husband and your wife don't have a hell to put you in. If the unbeliever departs in such cases, you're not bound, the Bible says. You have no God-given green light to participate in fornication. The pornia is what you're engaging in. And it will damn you to hell. I just showed it to you in Revelation chapter 21. I just showed it to you in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 9 and following. You are going to be unable to inherit the kingdom of God because you are now subjecting yourself to your husband's and your wife's desires for you to participate in fornication, the pornia, and it will damn you. I don't care who doesn't like it. I don't care if it brings all kinds of disparities and disharmony into your home. I don't care. Because our job is to save souls from a burning hell that's eternal. I'm not interested in your temporary physical existence. I'm interested in your eternal life and making it into heaven at all costs. You've got to be desperate to be saved, good buddy. Salvation is for the desperate. Desperation brings salvation. Desperation brings deliverance. Those in hunger and thirst after righteousness, verily they shall be filled. If 1,000 of you hear this message, get off of the fence. The fence is on fire. Get in. The 1,000 of you that views this message, go to www.omegaministries.org. Help us establish the Dunamis Tabernacle. It's a base camp for what? A military operation. What are we here for? To go into all the world to preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. You'll talk with new tongues. You will lay hands on the sick. They'll recover. You eat or drink any deadly thing. It won't harm you. You will cast out demons. You'll take up or put away serpentine entities, demons. And the Lord will go with you, working with you, confirming your words with signs following. You got to have a base camp. You got to have an amalgamation of the church people coming together as a house of prayer, seeking the Lord, bombarding heaven collectively. There is nothing more powerful than covenant prayer, joined together, in unity together, seeking the Lord by day and by night. That's the power of the church. Sanctification unto salvation and seeking the Lord together. Not microscopically examining each other. Not caught up in you and on what you're doing. I don't even care. Let's get on our faces before God and seek the Lord for an outpouring of the Holy Ghost and power to save these people's lives. If you mean business, get in this thing. Folk might think, hey, you're just envious of T.D. Jakes or envious of Creflo Dollar or envious of Kenneth Copeland. You know, really, I don't care what they have. I could care less. I don't care if Creflo Dollar has 5,000 Bentleys. I could care less. But don't bring that in here, making that a doctrine. Don't preach it to the church as a doctrine. What you materially have has no bearing on anything. A guy could theoretically be a contractor that builds skyscrapers, and he's called to be a minister of God. He's worth $2 billion. You can't make that guy evil. The warped mind that examines material possessions, whether negatively or positively, is not spiritual, because it has nothing to do with this over here. Don't bring that over here as a doctrine. Don't try to make people seek after money as a manifestation of God doing something. You can't take that to Africa and preach that, because it won't work, because the folks can't get the stuff you're preaching about. If your gospel cannot be exported to the whole world, it's not the gospel. So the gospel of prosperity cannot be the gospel. It's of no consequence. It has no bearing what a person has or doesn't have. I don't care how much diversity is in this room as far as material possessions. It makes no difference to the gospel. Has nothing to do with it. People will use that as a way to monitor you, what you have or don't have. It's like them telling the man, the lady that's opening the alabaster box and perfuming Jesus' feet. We could have took that money and given it to the poor. And Jesus said, leave her alone. She's anointed me for burial. The poor you'll always have with you. You see how people are? And you know who's doing it? Stink Judas. He wasn't concerned about the poor. What was he concerned about? He's the treasurer keeping the money. This idiot is putting spices and ointments on Jesus' feet. That was $300 more I could have stole. And here you are giving it to the Lord. I'm going to show you how pitiful this is. This is how pitiful it is. This is very pitiful what I'm about to say. It's so pitiful you might go outside and start weeping. We had about 1,200 people that viewed the message last week. We're talking about a group of people not buying a pack of gum, not going to Starbucks, not eating McDonald's every day for lunch, but taking a sack lunch. This is how, now look how pitiful this is now. We're not talking about you going somewhere and giving $1,000 line, a $500 line, a $100 line. We're talking about crumbs. Just don't buy a pack of gum. Instead of buying that dentine to keep trying to keep your breath fresh, just gargle with Listerine before you leave the house. We're talking about something that is so pitiful to launch a war against the devil that you almost got to sit back for a minute and almost look at it like, is this possible? Is this really happening? While the faithful few people carry the load. Not carrying a load to project us just to stay alive and on the air doing the little bit we're doing. We're right there with 1,000 people going to listen to this week now. By Wednesday or Thursday, 1,000 people would have seen this. Even more would have heard it as we posted on by MP3 on the internet. And that unclean, perverse spirit, that religious spirit that they came out of. So you didn't know in that church you went to, you didn't just receive the doctrine. You received the demons that promoted the doctrines. And it's got your mind hung up between two worlds. Between the flesh and the spirit. Between God and the devil. Between Christ and the Antichrist. And all I'm telling you is, sell the farm and get in. Well, I don't believe you're going to. You watch what we'll do. It won't take you 6 months to monitor what we do. If we do something contrary to what I'm saying, then cut it off. Don't give a dime. But I guarantee you, if you're not for real, you're going to get more scared as you watch what we're doing. That's why you better get for real now, because we're going to do what I'm saying. Project force against the enemy. It's going to start an uprising. It's going to start a reaction. See, the devil's not going to let you come into territory and not react to you. He's going to stand up. He's going to stand up to religion and government, the two primary forces he's got at his disposal. To cast you down, castigate you, and destroy you. We got to do a quick work, a short work. I'm making a clarion call, especially to men, to break free from that stinking, whorish Jezebel spirit, man, and stand up for the first time in your life, in most cases, for something that is bigger than you, something that is more important than you, something that won't accommodate your little sissy emotions, and get in and fight. For the first time in your life, stand up and fight. Women of war are going to stand up by nature anyway. A lot of women don't fight for the sake of seeing women pastors because they don't want to be up under a woman pastor. A real woman don't want to be up under a woman. A real woman is tailor-made by God to complement, supplement, and walk with a man. The discussion won't even come up. Women's rights and trying to promote women to do this, that, and the other. It's inconsequential. Nobody even cares. But the sodomite spirit got you trying to be a man. Stop trying to be a man and let God remake you into a woman. So you can get peace in your mind. Sex mania. The devil's inroad through the Jezebel spirit to bind the church. Sex freaks everywhere. Recording industry. Full of it. Just look at them. Freaks. Singing and rapping into people's minds all day long. Even the women have been taken over by it. Lil' Kim, Foxy Brown, Trina, and Nicki Minaj. We use that picture as the calling card for this message. Kim Kardashian, sex tapists are enrolled into popularity and becoming a multimillionaire. A stinking filthy sex tape is your way in, just like Pam Anderson. A stinking filthy sex tape, your claim to fame. Paris Hilton, a stinking filthy sex tape, your claim to fame. Beyonce, standing out in a thong now, looking like somebody crazy. Sex, your calling card. Rihanna, butt naked now in magazines in Europe. Reality TV, we don't even talk about reality TV, the things these girls say is whores. The Housewives of LA, the Housewives of New York, the Housewives of Atlanta, basketball wives, hip-hop wives, preacher's wives, ex-preacher's girlfriends, the next show they're trying to put out there. These women have mouths like sewages. They say everything stinking, sexually perverse thing you can name. Madonna came up piggybacking on sex mania, a sex goddess, a sex freak. Go back in time to Marilyn Monroe and all the sex goddesses of Hollywood. Remy Ma, rapper from New York, 8 years in jail, says some of the most perverse sexual filth ever heard in rap music on her songs. 8 years in jail for shooting a woman in the stomach over money. I think she's about to get out now. Married to some little sissy guy. I can't remember his name. It's something like Poochie Boy or Pocahontas or something like that. One of these kids might know the guy's name, but something like that, though. Papaya, Papuchio, Popcorn Boy, Papoose, Papoose, Papoose. A little Indian girl's little baby, Papoose. This is crazy. Look, I'll wrap it up with this. It's like we're living in the Twilight Zone. That music that came on with the Twilight Zone, you know. And then the guy says, your mind is going away into another dimension where there's no reality. There's no tangible existence. My friend, you're entering into the Twilight Zone. That's what life has become. You hear and see stuff that is unbelievable. Like this can't be real, and yet it's real. And the folks in church, calling themselves saints of God, the saved army of God, sit there just looking. Don't let yourself become a silly message junkie. That all you want to hear is messages. Pulling out another message off of the internet. Wait for Sunday at 1:30 to hear another message. When are the messages going to be posted? And you do nothing but become a message junkie. Not progressing, doing nothing tangible. We say, look, let's get a base camp. Let's build a force and take the kingdom by force. Ground level, invasion, in the world, not backing down one inch. Something tangible, something you can put your hands on. A force to be reckoned with. Get off of this message. Go to www.omegaministries.org. Hit the support button. Hit the donate button. And donate. We want to see Dunamis Tabernacle up and operating by the time we get out of here in August. We want to get in and get going. It's time to do something about this. As the Presbyterian Church abdicates, Baptist Church abdicating, everybody abdicating, everybody allowing, everybody bowing the knee, everybody saying it's okay. No, man. Sex mania has taken over the world. Maniacs driven insane by sex. They talk about it all day long. They rap about it all day long. All the rap songs in the hip hop genre is bathed in sex talk. What I'm doing to her. How I'm doing this to her. Oral sex permeates the rap game. All they talk about is some girl performing oral sex on them. The girl's talking about some man performing oral sex on them. It's the spirit. It's the calling card of the demonic world. That's the spirit that began back in the 70s with Linda Lovelace in that movie Deep Throat, teaching women how to perform oral sex on a guy, deep throating his penis and not gagging when she's doing it. That became middle class cultural depravity that was exposed to the whole world, and it became in vogue. They had classes teaching women how to do it. Thank God Linda Lovelace came to herself out of that pornographic world and got saved later. Harry Reams, the guy that was in the mess too, doing the sexual filth, came and got saved out of that depravity. That's my prayer for Nicki Minaj, Trina, Beyonce, Rihanna, all these folks bathed in sexual depravity, that somehow God will save their souls from a burning hell. Because make no mistake about it, in sin and depravity, you're already damned. You're not going to be damned. You're already damned, like Bill Clinton said years ago. People say that the land is going to be judged because of homosexuality. He said, can't you see that homosexuality is the judgment? God has given them over to a reprobate mind. That is the judgment. That you believe you were born this way, that this is a natural orientation, I'm transgender and God made me this way. Can't you see that is the judgment? The reprobate mind. Stand up. You see what we're preaching. It's not the same thing. We're not going to do the same thing. We're not into a mega mess. A mega church called a mega mess by me. We're not here to have a mega mess called a mega fest. We're here to get a gospel preached to the world, preparation for departure. He's going to give it over to Satan. You glean out God's people and he leaves with them and he gives it over to the devil. I believe to rule and reign for 3.5 years. People talk about post-tribulation rapture, mid-tribulation rapture, pre-tribulation rapture. That pre-tribulation rapture stuff, you can data dump that. Mid or post have the same goal, to prepare for tribulation and suffering. So no matter how that pans out, it doesn't matter. That's why I don't even debate mid-tribulation or post-tribulation, because if it's preparing you to go through austere times, tribulation and suffering, you'll be okay. But see, pre-tribulation rapture tells you you don't have to go through anything, you'll be gone. That's the lie. Because as you see God's people actually separate wheat from tares, that's when you'll be identified as, by the devil, as somebody that must be annihilated. You know why? Because what he had embedded in the church has been extricated from the church. He can't control that which is not contaminated by himself. The devil has only the authority to govern his body. He doesn't govern the body of Christ uncontaminated by him. So when you are holy and separated away from him, he's afraid of you, because he can't control you. So he now has to marginalize you and identify you as an enemy of the state. Somebody that is homophobic, intolerant, discriminatory, prejudiced. You're against the civil rights of this minority group, the LGBT community, lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender community. They are the new blacks. We are the KKK that hates them. And the devil's carrying this out. He's actually getting away with this. All because he brought that Trojan horse of oral sex into the church. And it's all in the pews, all in the church. Married couples. Most folks you deal with in life participate in it. That's why they don't like Christ. It's the unclean spirit embedded in a stealth fashion. They become sex maniacs. We have been subjected by the devil to sex mania. And it's time to get every vestige of this filthy sexual invasion out of us. In the 60s, 70s, and 80s, they called it the sexual revolution. Free love. If it feels good, do it. Take all the holes off. All the restraints off. And what you got is sexual depravity at the highest level ever in the history of the world. Sex mania. We got to get as far away from it as we can. And rise up to meet the occasion. In Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for this time of sharing. Thank you for the word of God. God, anchor this word to the minds of the hearers and the body of Christ that can see it. Expunge them of all defiling demons. Make a man into a man from the ashes of a depraved homosexual spirit participating in oral sex. Make a woman into a woman from the ashes of the depraved lesbian spirit participating in oral sex. Raise them up as specimens of your grace and your mercy, and engage them in the warfare necessary to destroy the works of the devil. For this purpose, yes, is the Son of God manifested in these physical bodies that you see are yours, to destroy the works of the devil. In Jesus' name, I curse the oral sex demon. Right now, I pronounce a perpetual curse on the oral sex demon. From the east to the west to the north and the south globally, I curse it, and I dispatch a whole entourage of angels to destroy that demon. Hunt that demon down and utterly destroy it. By my command, go forth and destroy that demon. In Jesus' name, every vestige of it, eradicate it from the body of Christ and raise up the people, God, that have been delivered from that devil. Pornography, masturbation, homosexuality, oral sex, anal sex, bestiality, incest. Every evil work of that perverse spirit, divine through the Jezebel spirit, destroy those yokes. The Bible says the yoke shall be taken from off of our necks because of the anointing. The anointing breaks the yoke. And for an anointing to break the yoke, somebody must speak it. And I'm speaking it now. Break that yoke that's binding the people to the flesh, the world, and the devil, disempowering them, making them unable to support the gospel, unable to step up to the plate. Break that invisible yoke in Jesus' name. Do it for your glory. Do it for your honor. Amen. It's going to wrap it up this week, folks. Contribute to the Dunamis Tabernacle. Power Tabernacle, folks. We're not playing around. Email me, gcprice@att.net. Let me know the monthly amount you can commit to. I'll add you to the list. It's about 75 people on the list. We're seeking after a minimum of 500 people to be supporters monthly to get this thing off the ground, to build a teaching center, a ministry center, and most importantly, a deliverance center. That ain't talking about us sitting around talking about being free. That's talking about casting out demons. You got to cast out demons, buddy, to get totally free from the damage done by them to your mind. They must be cast out. So you teach the people, you train them, and you deliver them to make them free. Also remember, August 22nd through the 24th, we're headed down to Destin, Florida for a conference. That first night, Friday night, we'll be looking at a presentation by Frank Hammond dealing with demons prior to having a deliverance service. Be there. Be there. Everything else you do is done sacrificially. Your freedom must come by sacrifice. Get there. Prayer of the Saints, will be praying our way through into the time of the of the conference. This Thursday and Friday, again, another 2 days of prayer and fasting every week up until the time of the conference. The goal is to set people free from demons. Demons have to go. We have to deal with them. You're not going to go around an army that's set against you. You must defeat the army that is set against you. You got to cast those demons out. August 22nd, 24th, Destin, Florida. Look at our website, www.omegaministries.org, and all the information necessary for you to register for the conference and reserve your room and all that is there. You're responsible for your own transportation. It's time to get on with this. We are sitting and watching the devil come in this thing like a flood he's coming in. And everybody's just sitting and watching. We can't watch any longer, folks. It's time to take action. Folk abound. Sex mania is taking over the world. Somebody has to stand up in righteousness and holiness. Also remember, last thing, the prayer line. Every Monday, every night, Monday through Saturday. 1-805-399-1000. 1-805-399-1000. Access code 409-367. Access code 409-367. Listen carefully, because every time I say that, somebody inevitably gets on the internet and says, what's the phone number? 1-805-399-1000. Access code 409-367. Join in for prayer. Join in for prayer. This is about praying through. It's not about getting on and praying and preaching to people. You know how people pray and try to preach to folk through the prayer. Pray to God. Stop trying to preach to people. Stop trying to pray for 5 hours on a little prayer line like somebody that's lost their mind. Say the prayer and move on for somebody else to pray. You shouldn't pray over 10 or 15 minutes on a prayer line. Use some common sense. It's time to stop all the nutcases and wackos and weirdos and people that's just religiously bound by all these demons. Stop it. Come to your senses and let God change you. You got to stop being crazy, first of all, for God to work in you to change you. Stop acting a fool so you can get free. In Jesus' name. See you Wednesday night, Bible study 7:30. Back here next week, 1:30. Have a good week, and thanks for listening.